All you industry writers, you guys should be writing for the people who aren't, I mean, because you guys really, I'm not saying this because I'm here. I mean, it is some of the most interesting and insightful writing about film today. And I want it to be more mainstream. I want it to impact the people who online go to the movies. Hey, I grew up watching the Oscars. I won't stop. I mean, there's no reason for me to watch it anymore, but I do. And I'm going to do it next year, too. Mm-hmm. But the Oscars are not about celebrating quality. And they're not the films that I personally admire. My three favorite films of the year had garnered, they garnered three total Oscar nominations this year, and probably by accident. and they were all three films were directed by women. And I'm not a Me Too guy.
Right.
It just so happens they were.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, there were really good films, but it's funny because this whole argument about Spielberg and Netflix should be involved or so forth. I mean, a lot of the thing is that when you look at what happens at the Academy, ultimately, the access to being there is one thing, but then the reality of being there is a different thing altogether. And money is, really still the number one thing that's critical to getting in the position. You obviously have to have the movie that fits the thing, and you can't do it without the right movie or the right talent or the right actor or whatever. But if you don't have any money, you can't do it, period. I mean, you're just not going to slide in there.
I think Netflix releases should qualify for Emmy Awards, not Oscars. That said, I'm not against Netflix making movies and adhering to their business model. If they offered me a few million dollars to make my next movie, I would do it in a heartbeat, and I would never complain if they decided not to put it in movie theaters.
Right.
You make a deal with somebody. You understand who you're dealing with. They give you the freedom to do something that's your vision, and you thank them, and you, hopefully it resonates with people and you move on.
Yeah.
And hopefully the TV critics rave about it. And it wouldn't bother me in the least.
Yeah. Well, ironically, Harvey, besides from the raping part, still, I mean, Marty Scorsese's now been, he's now going through with Netflix and that movie's coming out, but he went through with Harvey when he decided to go to bigger budgets and they did Gangs of New York. Harvey remade that movie essentially with Marty, but it was not really what Marty wanted, and he did it and he kept his mouth shut and he towed the company line and he said there was no other version and blah blah blah.
Well, if you sign away Final Cut, then
right.
We had
Final Cut, but he got threatened and whatever. But the point is that he he understood what you just said, which is if once you sign on to Harvey Weinstein, you're going to get the Harvey Weinstein experience. Once you sign on to Netflix, you're going to get what Netflix is. Or HBO or Amazon or anybody else. It's not. There's an arrogance to thinking that you're above it when you're taking their money.
No, absolutely not. It's still an ungodly privilege to be able to make a filmed piece of entertainment, and where it lands is predicated on your deal. That's all, and you should be happy as a clam either way. I've been fortunate enough that six of my seven films have debuted in theaters. The one that didn't premiere it on Showtime, I'm not unhappy about that. It's the one I didn't write, but and I didn't control. So it premiered on Showtime, and I had no qualms whatsoever. But, who knows? At the end of the day, probably more people saw that film than any of my others because it premiered on Showtime, pre-streaming.
And then it played on Showtime regularly in a good spot because they had an
interest. For a window or, however long they played
it. But they had a more vested interest in promoting it than if they had just picked it up for, little money.
Oh, no. They did pick it up for little money.
Right. It still was little money. Let's go back a little.
Go back in time. It's the Wayback Machine.
Well, the Wayback Machine, because, the funny thing is you share a Wikipedia page with another person.
The photographer?
The photographer and you are the same person according to this Wikipedia page.
Is that right?
There's
really?
Information about him and about you, and it connects to his, personal, his photography page, But then you're in it about October films and whatever, and it's like, it's like, what the hell?
Talk about worlds colliding.
It's the same person. There is no like individual information about either one of you, practically.
Please donate to Wikipedia so they can get it right. They can get their facts straight.
You need a fan to come along and sort it all out or whatever. Yeah. I don't ever know how to do those things. So.
But he's a good photographer. I'll take his credits.
He's a terrific photographer. Yeah. But, you know, different guy. October Films, you were 12 years old, 13 years old at the time?
October Films?
Yeah, when you guys started October Films.
In fact, October 9th, 1990, I resigned from Scurus Pictures to start a distribution company. And I was a day away from turning, 37.
So you're still young. By those standards.
I think I'm still young now.
Well, you are. But
but by those standards, I imagine, but sure.
So how did you end up starting? I assume Scorus wasn't the first stop either.
No. I mean, my distribution career, dumb luck. Dumb luck that my idol and hero from my age of 16 uh-huh. and no other 16-year-old on Long Island selected as their... cinematic mentor, John Cassavetes. The movie that changed my life was Husbands. And about three best friends turning 40 who have, are touched for the first time in their lives with mortality mm-hmm. and enjoy what might be the last irresponsible weekend of their life. And it was very uncharacteristic of John's films anyway, and of my ultimate films, in that his films often featured not just Jenna Rollins, but other actresses in strong, compelling, three-dimensional roles. Mm-hmm. This one, there were almost no women on screen except for a prostitute. And, this was about those guys mm-hmm. Being children. And I saw it when I was 17. But it was the first time that I watched a movie in which I saw people I knew. And I could somehow see my own frailties, coming writ large in these 40-year-old men. And maybe I saw myself, maybe I saw my father as an amalgam of the... Anyway, it was a film. I walked 20 blocks after I saw it at the Cinema One in New York by myself in a daze. Mm-hmm. And
those are the best memories I have of all movies.
That's why the funny thing, as a filmmaker, I very much enjoy doing Q&As, but as a film goer, I don't. Because films for me, the best films are transformative experiences, and I don't want to hear about what the cinematographer did to achieve this or that effect or what CGI was used. I want to lose myself and suspend disbelief mm-hmm. for as long as humanly possible. As a filmmaker, yeah, I'll tell you all the secrets in my movies. I don't know why you want to hear them. I mean, I'd rather you take my film home with you and live with it for days, weeks, hours, whatever. But anyway, getting back to that day with John, I had seen Faces, his previous film. It was over my head at that time. I was 15 years old, but I went back. I found a museum, a non-theatrical outlet. I watched it again, and it was starting to grow in me in leaps and bounds. The following year, I was a film critic for my community college newspaper and saw that John Cassavetes had made a new film, Minnie and Moskowitz. And so Universal was releasing it. They were the only studio that did not invite college press to advanced screenings, which frankly made them smarter than everybody else because nobody at college read our reviews. We read the New York Times, same as every other college kid.
Right.
But I was determined to get into a screening. I did. I connived my way into a screening at Lincoln Center in early December of 71, December 9th, I believe. And I went to see the movie. And honestly, I wasn't crazy about it. Loved the acting. Uh-huh. But we walked out afterwards, and in the lobby was John Cassavetes. And I felt like a teenage girl looking at the Beatles. Literally, I was in awe. I was fixed to the ground. I couldn't move. I was a decent film critic, probably not by your standards, but I was a decent film critic. I was a horrible interviewer. Horrible. Most banal questions ever considered, contemplated. Those were my questions. Mm. But I had to meet this guy. So I badgered his publicist at the time. Mm-hmm. Took a couple of weeks. She gave me an interview slot at the St. Regis Hotel in December of 71. 6:30 on a Friday night. I was late. I'm never late anywhere in my life. Mm. I was flop sweat. I was had my little tape recorder. Go up, expected a publicist to answer the door. No, John answered the door. He was on the phone, excused himself, got off the phone, shook my hand. I asked him if he would mind if I taped it. He said, no problem. I began asking him the stupidest questions for 45 minutes. And I was always afraid in an interview situation, if I ended too early, they'd be insulted. If I went on too long, they'd be bored. Finally, after 45 minutes, he said, can we take a break? I said, sure. Turned it off. And for the next two and a half, he offered me a beer. I had a beer. He had a beer. For the next 2.5 hours, we had the most revelatory conversation about life and movies and women, everything but Minia Moskowitz. And finally, he was called away to go to another screening. So he said, have you written your review yet? And I said, not yet. He said, when are you writing it? I said, tomorrow. He said, well, send it to me if you write it tomorrow. I walked out of the St. Regis Hotel on cloud nine. Oh, incidentally, I was on my way to an 11 p.m. press screening of a new movie that was opening the next week called The Clockwork Orange. It was one of the 10 greatest days of my life. I went home. I wrote the review. It was honest. Stellar little things about Jenna and Seymour Cassell. Uh-huh. And sent it to him at care of the St. Regis. It's between fall and spring semesters, and I was sleeping late, which I never do anymore. Lucky if I get to sleep at all now. Mm. And my friend called me, woke me up. He said, did you see it? I said, see what? He said, the New York Times. I said, no, why? He said, you're in it. I said, what? And in 1971, even a kid on Long Island, the New York Times wasn't even available at every corner candy store. So I went out, found it, Universal, the film had just opened, Universal had a half-page quote ad, Judith Chris quotes, Daily News, New York Post, Cosmopolitan, and Jeff Lipsky from Nassau Community College. I freaked out. I was flipping out. I couldn't believe it. I said I had to call him and thank him. I had no idea whether he was still in New York. I called the St. Regis, asked for his room. His then 10, 11-year-old son answered the phone, mm-hmm. Nick. And I said, is John there? He said, he's on the other phone. I said, oh, okay. Tell him Jeff Lipsky called to thank him. And he said, okay. So I got off the phone. I said, no. I have to thank him person or on the phone.
Right.
Called back. Jenna answered the phone, whom I hadn't met. And I said, is John there? She said, who's calling? I said, Jeff Lipsky. And I could hear her say in the background, Jeff Lipsky? And so John got on the phone. I said, I just wanted to thank you for quoting me in the ad. It was, I mean, knowing what I do now about distribution, Universal must have had a shit fit when he told them to put that quote in the ad. And they had every right to. And I wouldn't have put that quote in the ad. And so he said, no, I really liked the review. I thought it was honest. He said, listen, why don't you take my address in California and let's stay in touch. Next year and a half, we were pen pals for a year and a half. I still have some of those letters. And I let the correspondence go. I wanted to make movies when I was 10 years old. I wrote my first script, I joked to you before about The Man from U.N.C.L.E. My first script I ever wrote in longhand, green ink, was a two-part episode. Part one was supposed to appear on The Man from U.N.C.L.E., part two on The Girl from U.N.C.L.E. And I still have it.
Were they doing that at the time and you got inspired, or did you
come up with the idea of doing that? There were two-parters, but not crossing.
Not crossing over.
Yeah, not crossing over. Even then I was a rebel, right?
Yeah.
So I was on The Man from U.N.C.L.E. set. I was in U.N.C.L.E. headquarters. I mean, that tells you what a nerd I was at that time on a vacation to Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. But I let the correspondence go because that's when I left school and got a job managing movie theaters. And I loved it. I was an usher at 16. Everything I've ever done in this business, I've loved. And I was loving managing theaters. I said, you know what? I could do this the rest of my life. This is my career. I'm happy. So I just let it go because I was a timid little teenager anyway. Mm. And 1974, I'm reading Variety, as I did since I was 9 years old. And the New York Film Festival selections were announced, and there was a new John Cassavetes film called A Woman Under the Influence. And I immediately got myself a ticket, which was easy to do in those days. And I somehow, pushy I've never been, but somehow I made it my business to find out where John was staying in New York, which was the defunct Wyndham Hotel on 58th Street. And the day before I was going to see the movie, I called the hotel, asked for his room. This is John Cassavetes. He doesn't have, you know, handlers.
Right.
So he answered the phone. I said, I don't know if you remember me. It's Jeff Lipsky. He said, oh, Jeff, how are you? What's going on? What are you doing? I said, well, I'm managing a theater on Long Island. And right then he became really interested in me. I didn't know he had no distribution for the film. I didn't know he and Peter Falk had funded it. I didn't know how much he hated Hollywood, even though he was trying to strike a deal with a major. And he said, oh, he figured I knew everything about distribution. I didn't know anything about distribution. He said, come on up to the hotel. Sam Shaw just brought the posters up and blah, 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 blah. I went up. Of course I went up to the hotel. I don't know why this guy befriended me. There was nothing in me to befriend at that time, but he did. If I had chosen as a role model any other filmmaker, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you today. I don't know what I'd be doing. Hopefully I'd be successful. Or maybe I'd be managing movie theaters. I don't know. So I said, oh, well, I have 2 days a week off. I'll put posters up in all the colleges. I'm like, oh, great. I went to see the movie next day. I thought it was a masterpiece. And he had arranged to open it at one theater in New York and one theater in LA to get momentum started. It opened in New York the following week, broke the house record at what was then called the Columbia 1 and 2, opened the following week at what was then the Fox Wilshire, broke the house record. I didn't know at the time his offices were above the Fox Wilshire. And he said to the 8 or 9 sycophants that were, you know, like me, wanting to make movies or loved him to death, he said, fuck it, we're going to do it ourselves. We're going to distribute this movie ourselves. The only rule is, however the experts say is the way to do it, we're going to do it the opposite way. That was the first film in history to be distributed and marketed nationwide, forsaking the 31-city network of sub-distributors that existed at the time. This is when admission prices average across the country are about $1.60, and the film grossed somewhere in the neighborhood of $16 million. It cost $850,000 to make. And I became a film distributor. The reason, 3 weeks in, he said, why don't you just work for us? And I said, of course, because I thought sidling up along, you know, next to him would accelerate the process by which I could learn and make my own films.
Right.
I didn't realize it was going to take another 25, 24 years, whatever it was, because I made my first film when I was 41. But what happened was we were successful. If that film had failed at the box office, again, I wouldn't be a distributor today. I wouldn't be a filmmaker today. In the history of mankind, of humankind, there has never been a little boy, little girl, asked when they're 8, 9, 10 years old, what do you want to be when you grow up? And any of them have ever said, I want to be a film distributor. No, they wanted to be filmmakers, they wanted to be actors, actresses, but they didn't want to be film distributors. So we invented the mold. And it was there were other mom and pops that followed, one of which I worked for, Ray and Joan Micklin Silver. I distributed Hester Street Between the Lines and On the Yard. And that's when a guy named Nathaniel Quitt was running the non-theatrical department at United Artists. And he had these two glorified college students working for him named Tom Bernard and Michael Barker. And he said, well, look at all this money these idiots are making. Why can't we do that? And he arranged for United Artists to pick up The Last Metro. And that became the first studio boutique. And then we were all successful. And then we got, A Woman Under the Influence was nominated for 2 Academy Awards. First independent film to, you know, be distributed like that.
Right.
And right off the bat, Hester Street was nominated for an Oscar for Best Actress. Last Metro, Best Foreign Language Film. We were, you know, it was the 70s, our version of the Raging Bulls, Easy Riders.
Right.
Except on the business side of things.
And was there perspective as you were doing it, or were you just doing it?
Oh, we were just doing it because we loved the films we were representing, and we were making money. And we were, everything has changed, 180 degrees different. Exhibitors didn't know what hit them. We were running roughshod over the major theater chains, and which were prolific at that time. There were all these mom and pop chains, regional chains with power, and then the 2 or 3 major chains led by United Artists Theaters at the time, Salahassanine. But they didn't know what hit them. We were changing the rules every day, and they didn't realize it until after we collected the money. And it was absurd. It was obscene. We were cheating left and right. But it was fun. You know, Sam Shaw, John's producer, his son, Larry Shaw. Sam was a very soft-spoken, lovely genius photographer. Larry was a big, burly, rugby kind of guy with that mentality. And when somebody didn't pay us, when we were distributing A Woman Under the Influence, he would literally get on the phone with the guy and say, you stay in your office, I'm on my way over. And a guy I worked with who became a legend for a while himself, Blaine Novak, he would say, I'm going with Larry. And literally, he would show up at that guy's office, the guy would be gone, and there'd be a check left on the desk. Mm. I mean, when John hung out with New York gangsters and New York actors. And I followed John out here and then back and forth, New York and Los Angeles. After those two mom and pop companies, John being one of them, when distribution in those companies began waning, I was lucky enough to be invited to run distribution for New Yorker Films, which at the time was the number one distributor of foreign language. That was my education in foreign language films from 79 to 83. Again, more success, more Oscar nominations for those films. Then I wanted to go back to Los Angeles. So I mentioned it to a couple of people and I got an offer to run distribution for Samuel Goldwyn Films at its apex as an independent company. I mean, when it was the first fully integrated independent distributor in large part due to his family's library, his father's library. I had the greatest time in the world. And then I was offered a position with Tom Skouras, who was a great guy. I walked in the door and the first movie that I was told I was going to distribute was My Life as a Dog. The Academy changed the rules late in the year so My Life as a Dog could qualify for the Oscars. Really? Not for foreign film, but we ended up getting nominated for director and screenplay adaptation. Because it didn't qualify for foreign film because Sweden didn't submit it.
What rule did they change? What did they?
You could qualify for all of the conventional nominating all the conventional categories as long as you didn't open anywhere, even in your country of origin. I think it was a full year before it opened in the United States.
Right.
It had opened in Christmas in Sweden. By a week. And I wrote this, I still have a copy of it. I wrote an impassioned letter to the head of the Academy at that time on my IBM Selectric typewriter. And our offices were right here at Hollywood Center Studios. And I had a parking space with my name on it at a studio. You know, the only movie that shot there during that period was the first Addams Family. I got a call from the Academy. They were smart enough, even before the internet, not to put anything in writing.
Right.
I got a call, and that like 2 days later, I was sending it from Hollywood to Beverly Hills. And they said, got your letter. Listen, just don't do anything. We're having a meeting later this week. I got a call a week later saying, okay, we've changed the rules retroactive to January 1st, and the film is going to qualify. And I didn't make the movie. I didn't make it the most endearing movie of the year.
Right.
But I got those Oscar nominations for Lasse Hallström. After a couple of years at Skouras, Tom, who was a terrific guy, he was a great guy to work with, work for. But his goal from day one was to take the company public. I walked in the door and I was going to be one of the beneficiaries. I didn't know what that meant at that time. I see I'm going to get 100,000 shares of stock valued at one penny. I thought I was going to get $1,000. You know, I didn't know it was going to yield millions. And I wasn't an entrepreneur yet. So that was his great goal. But that first year that I worked there, we had millions coming in, and not just from My Life as a Dog, other titles too. It was already, we had an underwriter, it was going to happen, I was going to be part of the Dog and Pony Show. And then Black Monday in October happened. And nobody was going public. And it kind of soured Tom, I think, on the whole business. So that by year two or three, it was clear that my future at Skouras, I just didn't have, you know, if he wasn't going to have the same passion, I couldn't, you know, I wanted to really take this company places. And, you know, Tom didn't need to, and he loved it. And working for him was great. It wasn't Tom.
Right.
It was where the company was going. And his stepdaughter was a great head of acquisitions, Marjorie Skouras. She was fantastic. Loved working with her. But it wasn't going to happen. One of the few successes I had there in terms of asking Tom to acquire something for acquisitions was the first theatrical film by Mike Lee, High Hopes. And Tom said yes to what I told him to put up for the movie. Mm-hmm. We bought it. I got to work with Mike. The film was brilliant. We made a tidy profit, nothing huge, but mm-hmm. a good profit. But more importantly, it put me in touch with Mike's producer, Simon Channing Williams, one of the three greatest human beings I've ever met in my life. I didn't deserve to walk on the same planet this man worked on. I really didn't. And if I talk about him too much, I will cry. He is responsible for October Films. Mm. Nobody knows this. He's responsible for October Films. Anyway, we bonded. We bonded with Mike and Alison Steadman, his ex-wife, who was in the movie. Mm-hmm. They were great people. But Simon was otherworldly, unique. So we bonded, Simon and I. And it was successful, great. But in that last year at Scores, it was clear that I was on my way out. I wasn't forced out, voluntarily. And
the magic moment was over.
Yeah, and I got a call from Simon in London saying, listen, because we were always at the Cannes Film Festival, when you go to Cannes this year, why don't you stop in London and you can come on the set of Mike's new movie? It's untitled, we're shooting it. Mm-hmm. I knew we weren't going to Cannes that year. It was, the days were numbered. So I asked Tom, I said, listen, and he knew Simon just because of high hopes. Mm-hmm. I said, maybe we could go stop there. He said, I don't think so. So then in the summer of 1990, Simon called me and said, listen, why don't you come to England? We'll show you a rough cut of Untitled. No one else, and Film 4 was selling the rights at the time, but it was always Simon. Mm-hmm. And I told Tom, I said, listen, can I fly over? I don't think so. And so the fall came, and Simon called me. He said, listen, we've locked picture. Before Film 4 shows it to any U.S. distributor, why don't you come over, we'll screen it for you. And I told Tom, and he said, I don't think so. And I was married at the time to a woman who did international sales for independent companies, loved her, still do. And I said, look, I don't want to sully this one of the last remaining great relationships I have with film producers, film directors. Why don't we go to London this weekend and I'll arrange for them to show it to us. And she said, sure, let's do it. And so I didn't really have to tell Tom anything. I told him I was going to leave early on Friday, I think, for the weekend. Tom was very smart, though. So we flew overnight Friday to London from Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. It was arranged that my ex-wife and I were going to see Untitled at Delane Lee in Soho mm-hmm. in the morning, like literally coming right from Heathrow. Mm-hmm. And then we were going to meet Mike and Simon at a Chinese restaurant around the corner. We go to Delane Lee, watch what ultimately was called Life is Sweet, and I thought it was brilliant beyond belief. Mm. Walked around the corner, and I hadn't been discussing the situation at Scores with anybody, except, well, that's another great story, but I went around the corner. This is the first time. They said, what'd you think? I said, I think it's a masterpiece. There's just no reservations whatsoever. Mm-hmm. I said, so, are you going to buy it? And that's when I told them what was going on at Scores. And right away they said, you got to start your own company, man. We'll do anything to help you. You got to start your own. And I hadn't even, I did fleetingly think about it. That was that great story. Right. But, and then we were staying while we were in London because we didn't have untold fortunes. You know, that house in Sherman Oaks was pretty expensive back then. And so we were staying at a husband and wife, the amazing storybook factory. I don't know if you remember, there was a woman named Christine Edzard. She made mm-hmm. Little Dorrit, the six-hour film based on the Dickens Little Dorrit. It won the LA Film Critics Award for Best Picture. And I loved it. And that's how I had a relationship with she and her husband, Richard Goodman, who had also produced Murder on the Orient Express circa 1980-something.
Right.
And I had met them. They're lovely people. And they had this amazing duplex of factories right on the Thames. And anyway, we stayed there. It was like staying in a house out of Dickens. But she had just finished another film, also a Dickensian adaptation, and they showed it to us. And it wasn't something that really turned me on.
Right.
But so I kind of minced words a little bit when we talked about it, and they said, oh, well, you should start your own company, and we'll do it. So the last afternoon we were there that weekend, my wife and I were walking along the Thames River, and I said, you know, I'd really like to give it a shot. You know, I'm not going to do it unless you're supportive of this idea, because we have a lot on the line right now, but I'd like to give it a shot. And she said, you should. So I flew back to Los Angeles, walked into the office, walked into Tom's office. And the first thing he said was, so did you see Life is Sweet? I said, yeah, I did. He said, how is it? I said, it's great. He said, should we buy it? I said, yeah, we should. It's harmless. We weren't buying anything. So I resigned. Hmm. And I walked into my office. Literally, this all happened in maybe 10 minutes. Hmm. I walked into my office, picked up the phone, called Bingham Ray, whose career as a distributor I had been nurturing, who had been working for me at Goldwyn, and when I left, became head of distribution at Goldwyn, and in fact followed me as head of distribution at New Yorker Films even before that, and who was now head of distribution at Cary Broca's company called Alive. And I called him up. I said, I just quit my job. I'm starting a distribution company. Do you want to be my partner? And he said, absolutely. Now, he hadn't seen Life is Sweet yet. We figured, that was October, we figured with all of our combined experience, we'd raise what we thought was going to be $7 million. We thought that's what it was going to take as equity. Mm-hmm. To by can, we would have that money. Ultimately, we didn't raise the $2.3 million we started with. Did I say 2.3? I'm sorry, 2.8. Until 2 years later. Wow. If I had known how long it was going to take, I don't know that I would have had the balls to do it, to give up a very good paying job at Scores Pictures that I enjoyed. And I had a wife who was working, but a wife, and she made good money too, but we had a house. Right. You know, and at some point we were probably going to have a child, so who knows. But I did quit. Sorry about that.
And then you got a call.
No, I'm leaving. So Bingham and I, we had this business plan. We tried to meet every rich. We made weekly trips to New York to have meetings with any wealthy person either of us had ever met in our lives. And it started in October. We were getting nowhere by Christmas. And I was continuing to give Simon Channing Williams updates. And around Christmas time, he said, well, listen, we have an obligation to let them screen it for distributors in the United States. So there's going to be a screening in New York and one in LA. I said, well, that's actually great because now Bingham can see the movie. So he and I went to the screening here, which was at Raleigh Studios. And Bingham said, you're right, it's a masterpiece. So we kept in touch and gave them progress reports, which were anti-progress reports. Mm. And by February, they were getting offers now from established distributors, six-figure offers, low six-figure offers, but six-figure offers. And I cared too much about Simon for this to happen. And I knew the Film 4 people very well, but they're mercenaries. It's their job.
Yeah.
So I said to Bingham one day, look, we can't let Mike's film suffer. We can't hurt the film. Mm-hmm. I'm going to call Simon in London and tell him to tell Film 4 to sell the movie. We're not getting anywhere. He said, you should. So I called Simon in London. I said just what I told Bingham. I said, you can't hurt your movie. I mean, we have nothing. He said, well, what are you trying to raise? I said, well, we're trying to raise $7 million for the company, but for Life, if we were to distribute Life is Sweet, we have no MG money. We have no minimum guarantee money. And to do it properly, it would probably take $400,000 to market properly. Mm-hmm. He said, call me in 2 days. We called him in 2 days. He had raised $400,000 to lend to us for marketing money, told Film 4 to sell us the movie with zero MG, but a better back-end deal. And that's how October Films started. Mm. Had we not distributed successfully Life is Sweet, ultimately the money that Allen and Company helped us raise, that whopping $2.8 million, it wouldn't have happened. It just wouldn't have happened. And now I have other Simon Channing Williams. And the man died at the age of 62 of cancer. And he is not unsung, but he's one of the not sung enough real great producers and heroes of this industry.
So as you guys are going through all of this, are you just headstrong and sure that you will make a success out of this?
Out of the company or Life is Sweet?
Well, out of Life is Sweet and ultimately the company. But, I mean, they're risking with you, you're risking with
them.
We
had the greatest doubts when we called Simon. That's when I thought this might have been a fool's errand.
Right.
We had spent 4 or 5 months. We did have considerable successful experience as marketing and distribution executives. In my case, going back to 74, this was 16 years later now. And despite that, nobody seemed to care. Certainly nobody with the wherewithal to fund a new distribution company. So that's when I had my doubts. Had Simon not come through there, I probably would have dropped out.
And just gotten a job somewhere, or
hopefully. I don't know what Bingham would have said or done. Maybe he would have encouraged me to stay in it. Stick. I don't know what would have happened. I think that starting October Films and literally distributing Life is Sweet from A to Z out of my living room in Sherman Oaks. I think that that was one of myriad reasons why my marriage ultimately ended. My marriage ended. You can watch Flannel Pajamas to see some of that story. But I mean, I think that there were myriad reasons. But like, so I think most marriages, it's not because of infidelity or abuse. It just happens for all kinds of intangible or a totem pole totem pole's worth of reasons. But getting back to that, I don't know what would have. I think Life is Sweet. Once we had Life is Sweet, that's when things began happening almost spontaneously, in dribs and drabs. But leading up to the release of the film, which won a Los Angeles Film Critics Award for Best Supporting Actress, which was profitable. Again, meager profits, but profitable. That's when Amir Malin came aboard, who had co-founded Cinecom earlier than that. And then through a contact of Bingham's, I mean, that's how these things happen. Bingham knew an entertainment attorney in New York. I think they played cards or whatever. And who was a relatively young guy at the time. He's one of the biggest entertainment attorneys in the business now. I didn't know him. Bingham knew him. We met him in New York. He liked what we were all about. We had a, you know, stream of consciousness, that $7 million business plan, which frankly, the bare bones of it were adapted by Allen & Company, one of the biggest entertainment companies in terms of raise-ups in the world. So he liked what we were all about. He introduced us to a friend of his who was an accountant, entertainment accountant named Ken Starr. No, not the Whitewater guy. This was an entertainment attorney named Ken Starr. He liked what we were all about. Although he got involved in some kind of weird things later. You could look that up on Wikipedia, I suppose.
On his own Wikipedia.
And then he introduced us to a friend of his who was the chairman emeritus of the Film Society of Lincoln Center, this old codger who was wealthy, but wanted to get in on the ground floor of a new company, wanted a board position, you know, and I'll put in $25,000 or something. We liked him, though. He was a guy named Alfred Stern. And we met him, and he liked what we were all about. And a friend of his was president of Allen & Company. That's, what, 5 degrees, 4 degrees of separation, 5 degrees of separation? And that's how we got our foot in the door at Allen & Company. Once they came in, Amir had heard we were hooked up with Allen & Company. Well, to Amir, that meant a lot. And frankly, it meant more to him than it did to us. We were still naive. He already had the entrepreneurial experience. So we all got together then, and they liked us. Allen & Company liked us, but they always thought there was something missing. And once we brought Amir in, we didn't know at the time. They had a fair-haired boy over there named John Josephson. He was the heir apparent to the throne or something. But he was a young guy, money guy. We didn't know that he was day-to-day at the time prepping to take Miramax public. And he had been working with Bob and Harvey for 2 years, day in, day out, to take them public. And it was going to happen. If Allen & Company signs off on something, it happens. And at the 11th and a half hour, Bob and Harvey realized they were going to lose all control of the company if they did this with Allen & Company, and they told Allen & Company, we're out. And they were just livid, especially this young guy, this young Turk over there, because he figured it was the only way he was going to have a piece. His day-to-day guy at Miramax was their CFO, who at the time was John Schmidt. And John knew that when this went south, he was never going to get ownership of part ownership of Miramax. It was going to stay all the Weinsteins. Yeah. So he said to this guy, John Josephson, look, I'm out of Miramax. If you can think of something for me, let me know. And he says, well, we've been talking to these guys in Los Angeles, and they don't have a financial guy. Mm. We got a call from Allen Company. That had never happened before. And they said, we want you to come back to New York. We want you to meet somebody. As soon as we took on John as a fourth co-president or partner, that's when Allen & Company signed on to the deal. And then it was just a matter of months before the financing was complete. And this was after we had successfully released Life is Sweet, after, with significant help from and by Amir Malin, we had acquired the Bill Plimpton feature, The Tune. We had acquired a lovely Russian film, which was a bomb, but I still stand by it. It was a lovely film. We should have changed the title, called Adam's Rib. Gregor Aki's film, The Living End, which was very successful for us. And I take personal credit for this. Again, it was a Lipsky discovery, only because we couldn't afford to send Lipsky and Bingham Ray to Berlin that year. he couldn't discover it, because he would have. A French film called Tous les matins du monde, which is the title we released it under, and which was, until The Last Seduction, the company's biggest grossing film and most profitable film. So we had already acquired those five films, released three of them, actually had released four of them before that formal funding came in. So, but it snowballed. Right. Once we had Life is Sweet in our back pocket, then I no longer considered, you know, putting a stop to the whole process.
So it seems, I mean, it's funny talking about when the kids, particularly in the media, I guess, talk about, you know, the rise of indies and so forth, the Academy and whatever. I mean, that period of the 90s was really the first great rise of the indies.
It was. And in fact, at Scorus Pictures, we had the ability to distribute Sex, Lies, and Videotape on a service deal. Tom. And then when everybody had a shot at it, I saw it before Sundance, because Marjorie Scorus was tight with one of the producers of the film. And then I saw it, and I still think it's one of the great American independent films in history. And I saw it, but then they scheduled meetings with everybody once Sundance ended. And I told Tom, we had a great meeting. Tom wasn't in the meeting, but we had a great meeting with the producers and Steven. I came back, I told Tom, he said, where do you think we should? And only theatrical rights were available, which made it a very dicey proposition. Even then, even before streaming, even before pay-per-view.
What were the other rights?
Home Entertainment.
But I mean, who did they give them? Who already had them?
It was made by, who is it? Columbia, RCA Columbia. It was made by a home video company. So they had it.
So they had the money.
Columbia, what the guy's
name? Yeah, it was.
Whatever it was. And I can't remember the guy's name. It was a nice guy. But they were doing it because it was called Sex, Lies, and Videotape. There's no nudity in that movie. There's almost no sex in that movie. In fact, I think if you listen to Soderbergh, he'll tell you they kept pushing him to put more of that stuff in the movie.
So you go back for the reshoots.
Right.
It never happened, thank God.
But I said to Tom, we should offer $1 million. He said, for theatrical rights? I said, yeah. Now, of course, that would have bankrupted. If we did that, that would have bankrupted the company if it didn't work. That's exactly the deal Harvey made. The rest is rock and roll. So, but that was the same period. It was right at the beginning of the 90s.
And so the expectations when you were, even with Allen & Company, expectations were still fairly modest in terms of actual revenue returns.
I don't think anybody's. And, you know, the funny thing about what happened ultimately, because I was only there for 5 years, and that's when one of the basic tenets in our original business plan was we're going to avoid the pitfalls all the other new Tyro independent companies were falling prey to by avoiding production. That's how they all went bankrupt. And by the way, as a distributor, I'd be the last person to finance Jeff Lipsky's next film. An independent distributor has a certain skill set. And I've seen it happen all too often. When you stop minding your knitting, you go down. You go down sometimes with great films, you don't go down with shitty films, but you go down. So that was one. It was in there. I can show you the original business plan. That's what it said. Soon as I left the company, they went headlong into production. On one title specifically, they lost $20 million, which was the David Lynch film they did. But, and in fact, now I am not privy to the absolutely specific numbers, but it's my understanding, because I was gone, it's my understanding that when Universal bought the company, which was then owned by the, I'm hugely proud that something I started in my living room in Sherman Oaks ultimately was bought by what was then the largest corporation on the planet Earth, because at that time, General Electric still owned them. It wasn't, anyway. But I understood that when Universal bought them, the company was $40 million in debt. When I left the company, we had five consecutive years of profit. Now, I'm not saying that it was because of me. I'm saying it was because of strategic changes in their whole MO. It was production more than anything else. They had terrific success with other acquired titles, films like films I had nothing to do with, like Breaking the Waves, things like that, and which I loved, and then one I didn't love, but they had phenomenal success with The Apostle, which was a straight acquisition. I'm one of the few people that didn't love it, but props to them. You know, it's my legacy, you know. But then when they started getting involved with production, that was the end of that. When I
but
was
that became the thing to do.
When I was still there, they did dabble once, and it was an utter frickin' disaster, which was a film that I'm not going to say who. It wasn't me. One of the partners wanted to become involved with because they thought it was a sure thing. And it didn't lose us that much money, but I think it was case study number one that this is not what we shouldn't be violating, you know, principle A, which was a film directed by the artist or the so-called artist David Sally. He was one of the Gagosian guys. I didn't know. I mean, I don't know anything about art. For all I know, I say that. For all I know, he's one of the greatest artists in the history since Michelangelo. but he wasn't a filmmaker.
Yeah.
I didn't, couldn't quite, and then, so I'm told, I'm given the script, I read it. Now, I'm not a good script reader. The only the scripts I read that I feel I can appreciate are the ones I write. I'm not a good script reader of other people's material. I thought it was the worst script I'd ever read in my life. Which might be saying nothing, because I don't value my assessments
but
of
what
scripts.
You value is what you think of the film when you see a film. So,
exactly. Yeah. But I told them my feeling. But the reason my colleagues wanted to become involved is because it was executive produced by Martin Scorsese. And it was going to star Griffin Dunne, John Turturro, Christopher Walken, Rosanna Arquette, and directed by David Sally. But it was based on a Broadway play. Now, I'm not a theater guy, but I know what's going on Broadway. I had never heard of this thing. I went and it was before you could go online and Google it.
Right.
I went, had one of my assistants go to the library, dig out all the reviews.
Get the microfiche.
And it was one pan after another. You know, it lasted less than a week on Broadway.
Right.
One pan after another. I said, well, for good reason, obviously. I said, why? I don't understand. And it was Scorsese and this other guy. The female lead was going to be a woman who at that time was Scorsese's girlfriend du jour. Turns out she gave the best performance in the movie. And, you know, so that's kind of how Scorsese, that was Ileana Douglas, who's a lovely, first of all, a lovely person and a very good actress. But that's not how movies, you know,
get sold.
Yeah. You know, she was a nobody at that time. Yeah. And as I say, she probably gave the best performance in the film. Anyway, that was the first.
So why did you leave?
Oh, the lead investor in the company and on the board of directors, he didn't like me. And the feeling was mutual. And I had saved up, and I was divorced, and I had saved up enough money, and I'd written a script. I'd written quite a few scripts after The Man from U.N.C.L.E. But this was the first script I thought could actually make a good movie. And I said, I now have saved up enough money so that I don't have to ask anybody anywhere on the planet to finance it. I could finance it. And so given the animosity between me and the company's lead investor and my ability to do what I'd wanted to do since I was 10 years old, it seemed the appropriate time.
So you were ready to go into the life of a director, writer-director?
Which is what I did. I mean, there might have been 48 hours after my last day at October Films before I launched into pre-production. Or at least started hiring producers who knew how to produce. And I still say I don't know how to produce, even though I've had a lot of involvement. I have so much respect for good producers. You know, on Flannel Pajamas, which is my most successful film to date, I financed 60% of it myself. I wrote and directed it. It's semi-autobiographical. There's no way that film could have been made without the man who produced the film, a man named Jonathan Gray, who's one of the great entertainment attorneys in New York and in the country. I just have an abundance of respect for good producers.
So when you finally got behind the camera and your words were coming out of actors' mouths and it was happening, was it what you expected?
It was better. People asked if I was nervous the first day of production. No, I was exhilarated. I was bouncing off the walls with excess energy. I did wind up during pre-production because I just refused to stop. 3.5 days hospitalized with viral pneumonia. But had I been in the hospital one more day, I don't think the movie could have happened. But that was a small little pothole.
But it just was a fit. It just, everything you thought it was, it was.
Yeah. I'm still proud of the film. I think my subsequent efforts are better, but I got to work with great actors. It was my vision. I got to work with great producers who this year were two of the executive producers of the Oscar-nominated film Capernaum. And then the film did not make its money back. It was selected by San Sebastian. It was selected by Montreal. Mm-hmm. It got a good review in the New York Times. I was proud of my work. The male lead, Sam Trammell, was nominated for a Tony Award the following year, and then, 6 years as Sam, the shape-shifting bartender on True Blood. And the other actors were just as good.
So was that...
Edie Falco was in it. She was a day player on the movie, which gave me inordinate respect for her, because I was already a fan from her work with Hal Hartley, even though she was largely unknown to the public.
Right.
But to me, she was a superstar. It was my first movie. And there was literally a part that was called for one day of shooting. And I got my casting director's list of who was coming in to audition. And it was Edie Falco. I said, she's coming in to audition for this role? She said, yeah. And she came in. And I said, it's very nice to meet you. I'm an enormous fan. There's no point in you auditioning. If you're willing to do this, it's yours. And I realized that the best, and this has been true across my filmmaking career of 7 movies, the best actors, if they read something they like and they're available, the money is secondary. Even if it's a day of work, for an actor, it's like going to the gym and working out. They're getting paid. You know, they get to flex their muscles. Maybe they meet some new talented people to work with. It's like having a great day at the playground. And it's keeping in shape, no matter how good the actor is. And she is.
I have a friend who's historically a TV guy, and he was saying recently that he did a spot on a half-hour sitcom, and it was the best experience he had had in the last couple of years. Because even though he's had bigger roles and other things, this thing, for whatever, was the best character. It was like perfect. He got, 10 minutes of screen time, and he was like just thrilled to have done it, even though, nobody would really recognize it particularly. But he had the experience that he wanted to have.
Yeah, it's kind of amazing. Yeah.
So you make your film, and you have that experience.
And then I'm broke.
Well, also now you go through this thing where you're going to get accepted by film festivals and all of it. Is it weird for you to now be on the other side of that when you've had so much experience picking up films at festivals and going through that whole process on the other side?
No, but apparently it's weird for the industry. Oh. I think that it has hurt me in some... I mean, not out of animus, not out of... not consciously.
Right.
But I think that when you are valued in two completely disparate ends of the business, it's hard for people to wrap their heads around it. And by the way, it's what I began saying, and I kind of left, I realize now that I didn't finish the thought, when I told you that no kid had ever been asked what you want to do when you grow up. We had all wanted to be actors or filmmakers, but we got caught up in this incredibly lucrative career path. Mm-hmm. And then we got a little older and we got more successful. And then we got a little older and we got married or found life partners. Then we got a little older and we bought houses with mortgages. Then we got a little older and we had children or adopted them. Then they got a little older and they had all kinds of very expensive needs and they went to college. And you get caught up in the American dream. And the American dream says you don't spend your own money, the American dream on hobbies. The American dream says there's a certain trajectory you have to follow, and you better not deviate from that course. Otherwise, you're going to find yourself in quicksand. Well, that's the other problem I have. I think some people in the business, who I have inordinate respect for, because I know for a fact, I won't name them, but some of the, well, Bob and Harvey Weinstein, they didn't want to do what they were doing. They wanted to make movies, and in fact did make a film for Universal that was one of the most critically
pilloried.
Yeah, pilloried film in history.
Yeah.
You know, that's the way they originally wanted to go. Bob Shea, he ultimately got to do what he did. At least he did it, I think, with his own money.
Yeah.
There are others who haven't achieved those goals, but who, you know, fervently wanted to. And I think the fact that I did it seven times, I do think it's subliminal. But I do think, let's just say politely, it confuses the industry. And it's a difficult thing to compartmentalize what I do, what I want to do. You know, I just finished what I think is my best film to date. I think it's the best cast I've worked with, and I've worked with great actors. And the early results, and they're very early, have been superb. But okay, you know, that's going to take me through the summer of releasing the film, something I really never wanted to do and still don't want to do, release my own films. Mm-hmm. But it's the lot that I have found myself in. You know, so it'll take me through the summer. If somebody on Labor Day weekend, I meet somebody and they offer me a 3-year contract to be a distribution executive with Company X, I could be thrilled to take that.
Because you like the work, even though
I do enjoy distribution.
Work.
More importantly, I enjoy making money. And so far, it hasn't been, filmmaking has been
right.
Not a lucrative career. It's been soul satisfying. It's been provided me with the greatest pride, the greatest, sense of achievement that any, more, much more so than the honor of representing great work by other filmmakers. Mm-hmm. But because, you know, being a distributor, working for John Cassavetes, I learned more from him in 1 week about mm-hmm. how to write and direct movies than I would have learned 4 years in film school. Without question. You know, he was a dialogue writer. One of my favorite filmmakers today is, I mean, I have a couple of favorite filmmakers, people like Kenneth Lonergan and people like, but my favorite writing hero today is Aaron Sorkin. I mean, when you can imbue a visual medium with the kind of prose, the kind of mastery of the English language, which is an amazing language if you, mm-hmm. if you don't use it as a crutch, you know, these are people I revere. But you know, without distribution, I never would have had John as a mentor, a guide, a leader, a tutor. I never would have learned from Mike Lee, who was my second favorite European filmmaker. One of the very, very few regrets I have about my career in this business so far is that I never got to meet my favorite all-time European filmmaker before he passed away, which was Ingmar Bergman. Mm. And the fact that critics on occasion compare my work to Bergman's work, which I don't feel is deserved, but is mind-blowing.
And well, it's funny because you do have a, as a filmmaker, you have a niche that those guys all, it's because they're legendary filmmakers, but financially, they, none of them have been explosively large filmmakers financially.
True, and John put his own money into his own movies.
Right.
And frankly, his best movies were the ones he financed.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people are enamored of Gloria, probably more for Jenna's work than the film. I don't think it's a good movie at all, but that was a Columbia Studio movie.
Right.
And I think it shows.
But he also got paid, which...
And I got paid on my third feature, which was the one I didn't write. I was hired to direct. I got paid what I consider a lot of money. I got a check on the first day of, or I don't know what day it was. This chunky check. I said, I don't understand. You're paying me to direct a movie? I didn't understand the concept.
But that's a choice also that you've made. I mean, it's interesting.
Oh, no. I think my film Flannel Pajamas, my second film, was in dramatic competition at the Sundance Film Festival.
Right.
One of 16 films. Now, I'm not suggesting it was one of the 16 best films of the 2,000 features that were submitted, but they did.
Right.
And during the festival, actually, it received 3 reviews, one by a then still very hale and hearty Roger Ebert, another by The Hollywood Reporter, and one by Variety. Variety's was good and quotable, but Ebert and The Hollywood Reporter were raves along the lines of the best review Stanley Kubrick has ever gotten. And I'm probably one of the few filmmakers who had a film in Sundance in history with reviews like that out of the festival that still can't land an agent or a manager.
Mm.
And I think that's how you get paid to direct films. You don't have an agent, it's the way you get paid to write
films.
You
would like to get paid to direct films.
I would love to get paid.
You're not carrying a chip on your shoulder like you don't want to do this, you don't want to do that. You want to work.
I will tell you, in all sincerity, it's, again, I can prove it. It's in writing. When the year of Flannel Pajamas, which was 2006 at Sundance, all of the 16 dramatic competition filmmakers were asked a questionnaire, which was then every day they would put out another one during the festival, circulated around the festival. We were asked the exact same questions. And the last dumb question was, what do you want to do next? And without hesitation, it's there in writing. And I meant it with absolute sincerity. I want to direct an episode of The Gilmore Girls. Because I was blown away by Palladino's dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
I think that series had serious flaws, but the core characters in that I loved, and her writing for television at that time, I thought was second to none. And obviously the only thing I had misgivings about is that it should have been shot on the East Coast and not in Burbank.
Right.
But I meant that. I am a whore. I will whore myself out to the highest bidder, be it distribution or be it as a director, any day of the week. Why? Because I love distribution and I love filmmaking. So if somebody's going to pay me to do it, that's a win-win, along celestial lines.
So you don't think you've just been narrow cast in terms of picking up your films. You actually feel like you're having a hard time with... I mean, you being a TV director does not seem like a big stretch for somebody to come along and, you know, have you do episodic, you know, hour-longs or whatever. It seems like you certainly should be able to get that opportunity.
Yes, but again, unless you have an agent, it's not going to happen. It's never going to happen.
Right.
One of the most successful films I distributed at Goldwyn in 1985 was the first, what I call, over-the-counter lesbian movie. Same year as, Parting Glances was the first over-the-counter, big successful male gay movie.
Mm-hmm.
I distributed Desert Hearts, Donna Deitch's
film.
Still
a classic.
Great film.
Still beloved.
Great film. I loved it. It was hugely successful for us. And I bonded so well with Donna. And Donna wanted to make more features after that. What'd she do? She became an episodic TV director. But she had a successful film behind her.
Right.
And albeit one with explicit lesbianism when they're explicit lesbian sex at a time when nobody else was doing that.
Right.
And but that was, you know, she had an agent. She became an. I'm sure if you really held a gun to her head, she would have told you, no, I didn't want to go and direct TV series right. at that time. And it's not that given a choice. You know, I'm in the latter stages right now of finishing my new script, and given my druthers, that's what I want to be shooting in January 2020.
Right.
But if I'm distributing a wonderful movie that somebody bought for me, or that I discover at this fall's Toronto Film Festival mm-hmm. because somebody has a wheelbarrow of money and they say, you're a good distributor, here, why don't you buy this movie and do it? I'll be very happy in 2020. Mm. And I guess that's what drives people nuts, is that how can, you know, how do you balance, you know, who are you?
Who are you? Believe me, I'm going through the same thing myself these days.
Yeah, so... It's
what's interesting because the Sundance pipeline, there are the people who've exploded are the movies that have been hits out of Sundance, but the films that have been of quality, or are in the, you know, the cycle where people see them as the best films of that festival, even though they didn't get a big distribution deal or whatever, are often like they end up in doing television. There are very few of them.
I'll give you another example. One that I distributed at a Sundance, just what you just said, exactly right. I distributed the brilliant first feature by Michael Cuesta out of Sundance, LIE. What happened? Yeah. Bang. 6 feet under. He was executive.
Cuesta's made his fortune by doing pilots.
That's right. Homeland. You know, yeah. Homeland. Executive producer.
Directed
the pilot.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, once you...
Richard Shepard, same kind of thing.
Once you learn, if you're already not aware... that if you direct a television pilot, you get paid for every single episode till the end of time, even if you never direct another one. Yeah, no wonder everybody likes to, no wonder Burroughs likes to direct every comedy pilot in Burbank that exists. I don't blame him.
Well, Richard Shepard got sucked into that also.
Distributed Scotland, PA, which he was one of the producers of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's funny because we were having an inclusion conversation a couple years ago. I was looking at the numbers, and the only director to win at Sundance to ever get a studio movie has been Ava DuVernay. Not a single best director at Sundance has gotten a studio movie except for Ava, which is kind of fascinating. I mean, regardless of what we think of Ava, it's not the pipeline. You know, it is so much the pipeline, and yet it's also not the pipeline.
Well, I'll tell you, the one area of the business, or one area of distribution that I have zero experience in is working for the studios. Ava had that experience, and mm-hmm. I think that brings a certain other, you know, that brings a certain good baggage to her,
right.
You know, curbside that certainly other people that don't have that studio experience can't possibly.
So she has overcome people seeing her as a publicist and all of that. I mean, she got tagged with that even as Selma was happening. And has overcome it to whatever degree with, you know, within the community. So she's a hustler.
Yeah.
I mean, she's a very hard worker, she is, in terms of that.
Well, and she's very fortunate these days to be a woman, and a woman of color. It's like, you know, it's like she wins the Daily Double.
You are as white a white man as we could ever
find. Wait, white, straight, and a Jew.
Ugh.
I mean, the trifecta of horrible traits. I don't know what to say about that.
So how did this film come in? How did this film start? Where was the idea? What was the initial spark for this?
Well, I was itching to make another movie about 3 years ago. And I wrote a script that I thought I could come up with through my own savings and maybe a couple of people helping me out, a budget for. Mm-hmm. And I wrote a movie called Abigail's Surrender, and it was great. The script was great. And it was a period piece, 1974, set mostly outside of Dallas in a small town in Tennessee, Pennsylvania, with just a smidgen in New York. Mm-hmm. And I gave it to the guy I thought would be my producer. I said, here, budget it. It's going to be great. He budgets it. It's twice the money I could possibly have raised or had. And I said, okay, I'm never going to make a movie the rest of my life. That lasted about a week. Mm. And that's when I realized that I had released, as a distributor, three films in the prior 2 years, two of which were Israeli, one of which was an independent American Jewish comedy. None were particularly noteworthy, but all three did very well. Two of my top 20 movies in history deal with the Holocaust, Schindler's List and Night and Fog, one fiction, one nonfiction, or one dramatized bit. And this, you know, there's a channel that's jocularly called the Hitler Channel now. You know, it's the History Channel, just because it's 24/7 Holocaust or World War II or the rise of the Nazi Party. And I said, there's no more potent trope for adult moviegoers, and Jewish moviegoers in this country are still apart, other than Pixar or superhero movies, Marvel Universe movies, the most potent group of frequent movie theater goers there is today. So I said, well, if I could come up with, oh, that's what, it was right around then.
You're not a Quebecois or an Indian.
Right. So let me come up with something that involves some kind of Jewish thing. And at that time, my nephew was about to turn 30. And he had about 7 years, he grew up in a conservative Jewish family. 7 years earlier, decided he was going to become a modern Orthodox Jew, something no one in the family quite understood, and didn't believe in God. While he was in college, he was fixed up on a date with a girl who had always been fascinated by Judaism, even though she was Catholic, raised Catholic, was Catholic. And they began dating, and she became much more entrenched in Judaism and loved the whole modern Orthodox following that he had adopted. And she decided to convert, not conditionally. She just said, well, this is a great opportunity to really go whole hog and convert. And she very much believed in God. I had met her a couple of years prior, but didn't really know her well. And I said, you know, I love this bizarre relationship. And so I took them out to dinner one night with my tape recorder and sat down for 2.5 hours. And I wanted to know about more her than him. I mean, he's my nephew. I knew more about him. But I wanted to learn more about her upbringing and her mindset about this. So I said, wow, these are two great contemporary characters. Oh, I also realized the movie had to be written for something that could be shot in New York, not like Abigail Surrender, because I needed that 30% New York State production tax credit. So,
and by the way, your tape recorder is no longer a tape recorder, I assume.
No, it's not.
Okay.
I think it was my phone.
Because I'm imagining you with Cassavetes, you actually had one of those big square tape recorders.
Oh, that's exactly what
I... That is what the little ones back
then. It was a cassette recorder.
Yeah, but there
were no Walkman back then. And I don't know what happened to that cassette, and I really wish I still had it. I probably burned
it. It's in a box somewhere.
It was a terrible interview. So I said, okay, well, these are two great characters. But now I need a story to write around those characters. And I think that's about the time I came up with the idea of doing something. My films had always been about family, families in crisis, multiple generations of family, strong female characters, much like my mentors, John Cassavetes and Ingmar Bergman, and Mike Lee, and Woody Allen for the 25 years that he was America's greatest filmmaker, not the last 11 years. And by the way, I'm not talking about this latest thing. I'm on Woody Allen's side, lock, stock, and barrel. I just don't like his films in the last 10 years, except for Vicky Cristina Barcelona, which is a masterpiece. Those are the you know, the leitmotifs of all of my movies in to some extent. And I said, well, if I take it one more generation back, I'm at the Holocaust. But I didn't want to tell your average Holocaust story. I wanted to challenge audiences, as most of my movies do. I wanted to create a character that had never been introduced to audiences in movie theaters, on stage, in books. And how do you turn 30 years of abject adoration and love into abject hate in 12 hours? And that's when I came up with the character of Claire. And I wanted to reinforce that character with some factual information. And that's when I introduced two actual Holocaust monsters into her fictionalized life. And once I came up with that, did the little bit of research, because I was not a history maven in school, but did. And that's when I suddenly realized that we weren't approaching the centennial of the Holocaust. What we were approaching was the centennial of the Nazis' rise to power. And once I had all that, it became perhaps the easiest script I'd ever written. And the unimaginable on paper, but remarkable on film, 8 or 9 page monologue by a nonagenarian actress portraying a 92-year-old woman on a beach flowed out of me in, I think, one uninterrupted session. Because I'd already prepped and done research about Berlin before the 20th century, about Berlin, a little bit on the Weimar Republic, a little bit on the Nazis' rise to power, a little bit during World War I. And when Germany, at least in the eyes of somebody, somebody's mother, was paradise.
Well, it's also, there's a universality to it that obviously that is the subject matter and that is the period and that's critical, the details are critical, but also there is in all of her speeches and that character, there is a universality that is profound, I think.
Yeah. And I also, you know, the idea that I could write a lead role in a film for a 90-year-old actress in this age of ageism just filled me with glee. And the fact that I knew an actress who was brilliant and
so
who
you
I'd
knew
worked.
Her, you knew Rebecca Scholl already?
This was the fourth time I worked with her. I directed her in Flannel Pajamas. She played Julianne Nicholson's mother.
Oh, yeah.
And she has another monologue in that film, but a lot shorter, that blows audiences away. And then I wanted to write for her in every one of my films. And two of my next three films, I wrote smaller roles for her, which I think she was wonderful in. And this time, when I came up with the idea of Claire as a character, I said, holy cow, this is Rebecca. The irony, of course, about this movie is that of the five principal actors in the film, the only one who was in real life Jewish is Rebecca. And I just thought it was, there are three lines early in the film that have, I don't even want to give those lines away because then it's giving way too much away. But there's a line in, there's a Seder scene early on when you're still figuring out who these people are, when you're still learning about who they are, what their relationships are to each other, before you know anything much about Claire except that in the first scene in Central Park she says she's never been sick a day in her life and that she loves her great-grandchildren. Apart from that, you're still learning about people. Mm-hmm. And during the prep for the Seder, at one point Olivia, played by the brilliant Jill Durso, yells into the other room where everybody's waiting for the food, she's talking about how Catholics, you can be excommunicated. Mm-hmm. And somebody says something about Jews. She says, no, but you were born Jewish. That's something that can never be taken away from you. And you don't think about that when she says that. But of course, that's exactly what happens to her husband. Mm-hmm. And I love things that, and I don't expect audiences to remember that necessarily. Although the ones at the Chicago Jewish Film Festival, they were pretty savvy about recalling these lines. The other line is, no, I can't get into the other. There are two other lines I don't even want to talk about. But if you see the movie a second time, those lines will look like they're written in neon lights.
Well, it's also one of the things about seeing a movie in a theater compared to seeing it in a TV.
Sure,
That your focus level is so much different that you do pick those things up when.
Absolutely, absolutely.
It's easy to lose them in the thread on TV.
Absolutely. But that was how.
So you were kind of lucky that you had Rebecca, because I have a friend who just made a movie with a bunch of older comedian types and it was almost impossible to cast, because once you get to that age, you get into those late 80s, just, you know, getting through a shoot is almost impossible for people.
Yeah. Now, you know, we initially, the beach sequence in this movie, which lasts for 45 or 50 minutes on screen, was 33 or 34 pages in the script. And initially, I had this, you know, cowboy approach to my early crew members. I said, we're going to shoot that in one day. And when I gave the script to Rebecca, and normally I don't show scripts to any potential cast or crew people because I don't like jerking people's chains before I know I have the money to make and finish the film. But this time I needed to know Rebecca was willing to do it or not, you know, whether she would or not. So I met her for lunch and I gave her a printout of the script. I said, look, I wrote this for you, but you have to tell me. First I said to her, you need to, I worked with her, Flannel Pajamas, she was 76. Now she's 90. There's a big difference.
Oh, yeah.
And I said to her, but before you read it, I need you to tell me, if you were going to act in a play next week, could you be off book? And she said, absolutely, without hesitation. I said, okay, read it. Mm. 2 days later, she called me. She said, it's very disturbing, but it's great. I'm in. Now, Oh, so the first thing she asked me was, how long are you going to take to film the beach? Yeah, I didn't want to answer the question. I don't want to scare her away. So when I did answer, I said, we're still mapping it out. Mm-hmm. And a couple of days, I had to answer her question. So I told her, well, it looks like 2 days. And she didn't gripe or, you know, gasp too much. But because of something that happened in pre-production, literally 2 weeks before we were going to start shooting, I added a third day. If we hadn't had that third day, which was marred by 3 hours of torrential rains on the beach, I don't think we would have finished the beach sequence. I don't know if we would have finished the movie. But and the other thing to remember is that even though it's an 8 or 9 page monologue, thanks to an idea my cinematographer had, we filmed one page at a time. Not one page a day, which is what Hollywood would have done, but one page at a time. Because I said to the cinematographer, I said, look, this is what we've got. We're in a gazebo 300 yards in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean because we were on a pier that jutted 300 yards into the Atlantic Ocean. I said, we don't have a lot of latitude here, nor do we have a lot of time. We've got her monologue, and she's talking to her two great-grandchildren. So we need their reaction shots for the duration of this monologue, and we need Claire. Is there anything, without being obvious, without being grotesquely, you know, cinematographic, without hitting people over the heads, is there anything you can think of that we can do interesting visually? He said, well, you're going to cut it every page or so, you said, to give her a break. How about if you say cut and we take what it starts out as a medium shot, and after, and we go to reaction shots after each page, and the camera literally moves in 10 inches every time, so that by the last part, the most emotional, you know, emotionally pitched part of her monologue, we're in a tight close up, and the audience won't even notice. I said, it's a great idea. It's a perfect solution to the actor, to the visuals of the scene, and that's what we did.
So do you, in your style of directing, do you feel like you're, I mean, it's not completely Cassavetti-esque in terms of the movement.
No.
But you seem to be happy to let it, to stay with a frame and not jump around a lot. You're not moving the camera a ton.
That's kind of what Woody Allen did in his first, well, in the block of probably his 10 masterpieces, was he kept perfecting, honing the art of a still frame, but having characters move in and out of the frame, talking from another room. And if you watch, in fact, a movie I'm not a big fan of, but I believe it's Mighty Aphrodite. If you watch that and turn the sound completely off, you will realize probably for the first time, there's no editing in that movie. There is no, and you don't realize it because he became such a master at creating these shots. I think it's different when you look at the new wave Romanian films, brilliant masterpieces like 4 months, 3 weeks, 2 days, where those scenes are largely handheld shots, you know, where characters move in and out. I don't believe that's an artistic flourish. I think that's a function of a limited budget. When Woody Allen did it, he wasn't doing it for a budget. So I think
Dogma Guy is also kind of, so they moved the camera a lot, but they also didn't sometimes, and
they didn't
perfected ways of doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think there's actually a very strong visual character in most, if not all, of my films. But the first time you see my film, there's so much dialogue to absorb, you're not necessarily going to be aware of it. The last movie I made, Mad Women, which kind of freaked a lot of people out because of this thematic subplot, which involves a consensual sexual interlude or relationship between two adult women who happen to be mother and daughter. In the beginning of the scene, a longish scene, where they wind up hungrily kissing one another, I deliberately shot that film in widescreen, in what we used to call CinemaScope, even though it was digitally shot. I wanted deliberately to use that widescreen because in the beginning I wanted the two characters as far apart in the frame as possible. And as the scene went on and on and on, finally they are together in the center of the frame, kissing each other. But you're, again, you're not going to be looking at that as much as you are this mother and daughter making out.
Right.
You know, but in fact, the visual matches what's going on between the characters. That happens a lot in my films. Again, not that anyone should have to watch a movie two times to appreciate what's going on in front of and behind the camera, but it ain't a bad idea when it comes to most of my films.
Well, if you're engaged with a movie, there are things you definitely don't see. I mean, it's funny. I always say that, you know, as people used to say to me, can't you just enjoy a movie? I'm like, yes, but if I'm enjoying it, I really need to see a second time to gather the stuff that's intellectually about it. If I'm analyzing it as I'm watching it, there's something wrong with the movie. Usually.
Right, right. No, absolutely.
You know, there's a limitation there, so.
Absolutely.
When the film is over,
yeah.
What is your relationship with a film? Do you see them, are they like novels that you place on your bookshelf? Are they like?
You know, after they're over, the reason I, unless distribution intervenes,
right.
The reason I need desperately, sometimes it's good that distribution intervenes. The reason I so desperately want to make my next movie, it's not because I mean, as I mentioned earlier, I think that The Last is my best film to date. But if I don't make another movie, I won't stop watching The Last, even after it's finished. Even I find new things out about the movie after I've seen it 300 times. I'll reconnect with something that I consciously wrote 2 years earlier and had completely forgotten about and recall it for the first time.
So is that exploration of one as a filmmaker or one as a human being?
Both. So I you know, but I can't remember. I don't think that quite answered your question. But
well, no, it does kind of, because I mean, a lot of filmmakers, when they're done,
they never want to see the movie again. They don't watch them again.
3,000 time, they're
right.
Done. You know, they go to the premiere and one other thing, and then they're done.
That's right.
Never want to see it again.
Yeah, and I don't think that's the case. In fact, my savings is now depleted again because I've just finished a movie, but I need to make DCPs of Flannel Pajamas and my film 1230, because right now I have no way to show them in movie theaters, and I just need to be able to show the films. Even to myself, because I love them so much. And let me, if you don't mind, let me just go back to Skouras Pictures for a second, because I did mention that there was, October Films wasn't quite the first scintilla of a moment when I thought of becoming an entrepreneur in distribution. Late in the in my tenure at Skouras Pictures, when things were clearly not gonna be forever over there, I said to myself, I should start my own company, but where am I going to get money to start my own company? It's got to come from here. I was in Los Angeles. It's got to come from Hollywood. It's got to be from one of the most interesting Hollywood producers, somebody who's got a lot of money and subscribes to really making interesting films, not just cookie cutter type movies. I said, well, who's doing that? And this was in 1988-esque and-ish. And I said, well, I think some of the most interesting films coming out of the studios right now are produced by David Geffen. Geffen had just sold his record company, I think, for $1 billion, but he had produced Risky Business, which I thought was a really interesting studio movie. I really liked it. Mm-hmm. I also really liked Men Don't Leave, which he produced, and still do like both of those movies.
Yeah.
And I said, well, maybe Geffen's the guy to call. He doesn't know me from Adam. And I don't know any billionaires from Adam. At the time, Geffen still had his building on Sunset Boulevard in West Hollywood, the David Geffen Company.
Yep.
I called 411 and asked for the number for the David Geffen Company, and they gave me the number. One day, I picked up my telephone in my office, called the company, and I said to the receptionist, David Geffen, please. They connected me to his office. Very nice woman on the phone. I said, is David Geffen there? She said, who is calling? I said, Jeff Lipsky. And then she said the words that I hate more than any words in the history of business. Will he know what this is regarding? Well, the answer is, well, when he answers the phone, he will. But I was ready for it this time. I knew I was going to get that question, so I wasn't flustered in the least. And I told her in a friendly tone exactly what I was calling. What did it take me, 30 seconds, broad strokes to let her know? And she very politely said, well, David's not in the office right now. Let me take your name, your number, and we'll have to get back to you. Gave her the number, and I figured, okay, well, it's worth a shot. That's the last time ever. About 5 hours later, the same day, my phone rings. I pick it up. It's not her. I said, yeah, Jeff, this is David Geffen returning your call. Well, after I caught my breath and color came back into my face, I basically spent about, I don't know, a minute and a half, 2 minutes, maybe 2.5 minutes, explaining why I was calling, why I was interested in speaking with him, and what I had in mind. And very politely, he said, well, that sounds like a really exciting idea, really exciting venture. But I got to tell you, right now, I'm really happy. I have an output deal with Warner Brothers, and I'm really happy with the deal we have with them. They've really done a good job with my films, I think. So distribution at that time, and I 100% believe he was telling the truth. You know, and so distribution isn't something I really have any interest in right now, but I really wish you the best of luck. And that was basically the end of our conversation. And I got off the phone and I said, you know what? He just got on the phone with me for 3 minutes. And I realized at the end of every week, if he and his secretary went down his call sheet and returned blind calls to 50 people, I don't know, maybe he once recalls, my name was in Variety and it stuck in his head, or a trade story. Maybe, probably not maybe. But if he returned 50 blind calls at the end of every week, take him an hour and a half, and told everybody no, in the same polite way, with elegance and respect, that he said no to me, I hung up the phone and I said, if I am ever in a position to do something for David Geffen, I will do it for him. Because he treated me with such consideration, and it cost him nothing. Nobody in this town does that. Secretary didn't return the call. He returned the call. Took 5 hours. Right. He's a billionaire and a producer whose work I respect. Flash forward 6 years. I'm back in New York as one of the principals at October Films. Our most successful film during my tenure was The Last Seduction, John Dahl's film. At that time, everything was still 35 millimeter. And there was what we refer to, especially then, as the Bel Air circuit, whereby elitist studio executives and producers and famous people at large would call to borrow 35 millimeter prints of movies that had either not yet opened or were about to open, so that they could take them home, screen it for their girlfriends, get laid, get blowjob 20 minutes into the movie, and then say they saw it before anybody else. Well, here's the deal. With independent companies, it didn't happen often. But when it did...
You didn't have enough prints.
That's exactly right. These prints cost $1,500, $2,000 a piece. And I would explain to these people, well, apart from being offended that they wouldn't go to the movies or spend what was then probably $8 to pay for a ticket to see the movie, you know, God forbid they be seen in public as if the public were going to rip, as though every movie theater replayed Day of the Locust every evening. I just didn't have the money to have a 35 millimeter print sitting around so a bunch of rich fucks could screen it. And then there were people who truly loved movies, you knew they did, and they would have their office call for every movie. Woody Allen was one of those people, actually, at the time. And then the answer would be the same. You know, if I really wanted to be catty on the phone, I would say, but I'll call in passes at the theater for you, you know, if you want to save the $16. One day...
No blowjob in the theater, though.
What?
No blowjob in the theater.
No.
Well, I don't know. These days.
So my assistant one day... Are you okay?
We've burnt through the tape. Just give me a second.
Oh, my God.
Sorry.
You can just cut me off and throw me out. I'm fine.
Checking every once in a while just to make sure we weren't hitting the final note.
Okay, we've got 7 minutes. Okay. This next
part. We won't take more than another 2 minutes.
So you're not getting blowjobs in the movie while you're sending them to the theater?
Maybe some people did. I never have. So flash forward 6 years.
Yes.
Last Seduction is making a mint in theaters. My assistant comes into my office one Friday morning and says, David Geffen from DreamWorks, his office is on the phone. They want to borrow a printer, The Last Seduction, this weekend. And I actually did not have a printer. I said, let me talk to her. And I get on the phone and I said, I actually do not have a print available this weekend, mm-hmm. but let me tell you a story. And she could care less, but I told her the story I just told you. Mm-hmm. And I said, I am now going to move mountains to find a print for David Geffen to have at home this weekend. And I did. And it just made me feel good, if nothing else. Now, if you do lend those prints, Monday morning, the assistants, secretaries, colleagues, or whatever, they would always call Monday morning to thank you for sending the print. And on Monday morning, I got a call from the assistant. And she said, David just wanted me to convey his thanks for getting the print of The Last Seduction. He really appreciated it. But it did create a problem. And I froze. I said, why? What's the matter? She said, well, Stephen wasn't able to get a print. And I thought that was such a great moment.
And that's the relationship of Geffen and Spielberg. They're different operators.
If I called Stephen, he probably wouldn't return the call.
Geffen is one of the great characters in the history of this business in that he can get them smiling even when he's stabbing them in the heart, taking every ounce of blood they have. They still like him. They still love him.
I'll look like a Cheshire. He'll put a Cheshire cap smile on my face. That's for sure. And the other one, I never had occasion to try to call her or reach her about anything, right. But Sherry Lansing apparently also returned every single phone call.
Well, that was a thing with certain agents and certain executives that they returned every call.
There are some really smart people. I don't deal a lot with agents and managers. I mean, I would like one as a filmmaker, but I don't deal when I'm a filmmaker. My producers or my casting directors, they're the ones who deal with them. So I don't know many, personally. When I did Flannel Pajamas, by sheer chance, because I hadn't met them, Justin Kirk and Julianne Nicholson were both represented by Tony Lip, who at the time was a CAA agent. The two of them, Justin and Julianne, had never met each other before they did this movie. It just so happened they had the same agent, which, by the way, made the negotiation about who gets top billing easy for us. They would call us and say, I would say, you guys decide. We'll do whatever you want to do. It was so great to be able to say that for a change. Anyway, two films later was 12:30, which was the next film I wrote and directed. And we were in the early stages of casting. I had my casting director, who had been my assistant casting director on Flannel Pajamas. And I was traveling, I don't know why or where, but I do know that it involved a stop in St. Louis, just to change planes. Over, yeah. And while I was changing planes, I get a call on my cell phone on a Sunday. And it's Tony Lip at CAA calling me. And he said, Jeff, I just wanted to tell you, I just finished reading 12:30. It's the best script I've read all year. Now, I don't know whether he's blowing smoke. I don't know whether he's telling the truth or not. But how smart was it for him to just get on the phone? And, you know, I wasn't going to be able to afford his top stars no matter what. I might have gotten, as I think I did, two of his most talented actors in the film. And I didn't cast them because he represented them, but it certainly didn't hurt. But how smart, even if it's just, he was doing it not for me, but for his clients. He's the only one I've ever encountered like that. It's just, there are smart people in this.
As we go through this business of MB2 and this general sense of actually paying attention to how people treat each other in this business for change, so much of it seems to be who the person is in their lives.
Yeah.
The people who are kind, who've made mistakes, get the pass, and the people who are pricks make a small little letter and then they're dead.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it seems to be that way each time. It's like, so we say that, what's his name? Kevin Spacey, he didn't get murdered by the thing he did so much as the fact that his crew hated him.
Right.
And couldn't wait for him to be gone.
Right.
And so the,
kindness is, there's a lot to be said for it.
And I hope that carries over into my movies with my cast and my crews. I mean, you know, listen, in a crew, even on my penurious budgets, we did a count because we did a cast and crew screening. 81 people worked on the last, between pre-production, production, and post-production. And we did our cast and crew screening last week in New York. And when I get very emotional at those events. And in my introduction to the film, I told them in no uncertain terms that there's no other crew on the planet Earth that could have made a film of this caliber in 12 and a half days, except for you. And I meant it. And I want to share. My credit, written and directed by on screen, is no larger and lasts no longer than any other name in the credits. And, you know, I know what I did, and I'm very proud of what I did, but I also respect the fact that it's the most collaborative art form that mankind has ever created. Excuse me, humankind has ever created. And I'm very proud, speaking of which, I'm also very proud not just of the characters for women I create in front of the camera, but the fact that I've had so many key crew people who are hugely talented women, including the producers of my films very often. So, that's part of the fun too.
Yeah. Well, all the best filmmakers seem to have the same family, kind of repeat.
I would have totally the same families if I could afford them. The problem is they are so damn talented. My budgets haven't risen, but they need to make a living, and I respect that too.
Well, you've managed to walk that tightrope, it seems, as well as anybody ever could. So, well, you have a lot to be proud of.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time. Appreciate
thank you it. For yours. And it was a pleasure to sit down with you for a little while.
And for me, too.
And do you mind if I run to the bathroom for a few seconds?